announcing the arrival of His Highness Tengku Amir Shah, Ibni Sultan Sharafuddin Idris Shah, Raja Muda of Selangor. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Menghadap ke bawah duli yang teramat mulia, Tengku Amir Shah Ibni Sultan Sharafuddin Idris Shah Alhaj, Raja Muda Selangor, patik mewakili seluruh warga kerja Majlis Distinguished Lecture Series on Youth Wellbeing, merapat sembah, menjunjung kasih yang tidak terhingga di atas perkenan duli tuanku mencemar duli berangkat ke majlis ini. Ampun tuanku, mohon perkenan ke bawah duli tuanku untuk memulakan acara pada pagi ini. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh dan salam sejahtera. Yang hormat Datuk Profesor Dr. Muhammad Ruslan Sulaiman, Vice Chancellor Universiti Putra Malaysia UPM. Yang dimuliakan Tengku Datuk Dr. Jamaluddin bin Tengku Mahmud Shah. Yang dimuliakan Tengku Orang Kaya Maha Bijaya Sepang Orang Besar Daerah Sepang. Yang berbahagia, Datuk Dr. Jailani Johari, Lembaga Pengarah Universiti. Yang berusaha, Puan Nurul Azwar Muhammad Rozi, Chief Executive Officer Selangor Youth Community, SAY. Yang berbahagia, Profesor Dr. Abdul Aziz Bagaud, Dean International Institute of Islamic Thoughts and Civilization, ISTAC, International Islamic University of Malaysia, IIUM. Yang berbahagia, Profesor Dr. Haslida Abdullah, Director, Institute for Social Science Studies, IPSAS, University Putra Malaysia, Top Management of UPM, Senior Officers of UPM, Distinguished Guests, Ladies and Gentlemen, Boys and Girls, welcome to the Distinguished Lecture Series on Youth Wellbeing, organized by Institute for Social Science Studies, IPSAS, University Putra Malaysia, and jointly organized by Selangor Youth Community, SAY, and International Institute of Islamic Thoughts and Civilization, ISTAC, International Islamic University, Malaysia, IIUM. Ladies and gentlemen, let me welcome Al-Fadil Ustaz Al-Zasha Ilyin Zainal Alam, Senior Officer Islamic Affairs, Islamic Center, University Putra Malaysia, will recite the Thanksgiving prayer.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and very good morning. Al-Fatiha. Auzubillahi minasyaitanir rajim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Arrahmanirrahim. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdinas siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladzina an'amta 'alaihim ghairil maghdubi 'alaihim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين الحمد لله رب العالمين حمدا حامدين حمدا يوافي نعمه ويكافي مزيده يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك الكريم وعظيم سلطانك سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك فلك الحمد حتى ترضى ولك الحمد إذا رضيت ولك الحمد دائما أبدا O Allah, you are glorified and praised, your name is blessed, your majesty is exalted, and none has to the right to be worshipped but you. O Allah, we thank you for your kindness in making possible for us together here today for this occasion, distinguished lecture series on youth well-being. O Allah, grant lasting safety, health and well-being to His Highness Tengku Amir Shah Ibn Sultan Sharafuddin Idris Shah Alhaj, Raja Muda of Selangor, and to all the royal family. Allahumma ya arhamar rahimin. O Allah, we definitely praise you and we seek your aid and we seek your guidance and we seek your forgiveness and we believe in you and we place our trust in you. We thank you and we don't deny you. O Allah, please bring up our effort to discover knowledge and new findings in order for us to benefit our religion, people and nation. Allahumma rabbana atina fid dunya hasanah wa fil akhirati hasanatan wa qina adhaban nar. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa barak wa sallam. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
Amin, amin, ya Rabbal Alamin. Thank you very much, Al-Fadil Ustaz, for the doa just now. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to invite Yang Hormat Datuk Profesor Dr. Muhammad Roslan Sulaiman, Vice Chancellor Universiti Putra Malaysia, to deliver the welcoming address.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. His Highness Tengku Amir Shah Ibni Sultan Sharafuddin Idris Shah Alhaj, Raja Muda of Selangor. Yang dimuliakan Tengku Datuk Dr. Jamaluddin bin Tengku Mahmud Shah Alhaj. Yang dimuliakan Tengku Orang Kaya Maha Bijaya Sepang, Orang Besar Daerah Sepang. Yang berbahagia Datuk Seri Jalaini Johari, Ahli Lembaga Pengarah Universiti Putra Malaysia, Mrs. Nurul Azwa Muhammad Rozi, Chief Executive Officer Selangor Youth Community, or SAIS, Professor Dr. Abdul Aziz Bergaut, Dean International Institute of Islamic Thoughts and Civilization, ISTAC IIUM, Professor Dr. Haslinda Abdullah, Director, Institute for Social Science Studies, or IPSAS, Top Management of UPM, Senior Officers of UPM, Distinguished Guests, Ladies and Gentlemen. First of all, let us praise to the Almighty Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. All praise is due to Allah, the Merciful, the Beneficent. Salawat and salam are always given to our Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, his family and all his companions. Ladies and Gentlemen, Assalamualaikum Warahmatullahi Wabarakatuh. And salam sejahtera. Alhamdulillah, all praise and thank be to Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala for its due to His mercy and blessing that we are able to gather here today for the inaugural lecture of the Distinguished Lecture Series on Youth Wellbeing, organized by the Institute for Social Science Study, or IPSAS, University Putra Malaysia, in collaboration with International Institute of Islamic Thought and Civilization, ISTAC, International Islamic University Malaysia, and the Selangor Youth Community. First and foremost, allow me on behalf of the University Putra Malaysia to express our sincere gratitude to His Highness Tengku Amir for his presence at today's event. His Highness was promulgated as a Pro-Chancellor of University Putra Malaysia early this year during our 44th convocation ceremony. The UPM community is especially honoured and proud that today's inaugural lecture will be delivered by His Highness. Ladies and gentlemen, this lecture series will feature well-known figures from various fields related to youth and their well-being, and will be held 3 times a year, inshallah. The series is an extension of our own UPM Youth Study Program offered by IPSAS, and it aims to bring scholarly attention to the enormous challenges and current issues affecting young people in Malaysia and globally. IPSAS is working in collaboration with the International Institute of Islamic Thoughts and Civilization and the Selangor Youth Community. The series will also hopefully strengthen the cooperation between these three entities, leading towards wider collaboration in the field in accordance with the role of IPSAS as a research hub at UPM. Ladies and gentlemen, the continuation of the national development agenda must involve youth as partners. Our youth are the heirs of the country. However, it is a challenge to prepare a solid and well-versed generation of heirs. Youth are facing major challenges, both locally and globally, and many are feeling defeated and powerless to keep up with the world in continuous flux. Nevertheless, those who are able to thrive with change, their stories and success should be shared so that society understand that youth is not a liability but a valuable asset for the country. The National Youth Development Framework focuses on highlighting youth potential. Study shows that highlighting the potential of youth is an effective framework for realizing a dynamic youth development landscape. Academically, this framework is also called Positive Youth Development, or PYD. PYD is an approach that recognizes the potential of youth and forms the backbone of the current National Youth Development Policy, of which IPSAS, IPSAS play a major role in formulating. PYD provides an alternative to the deficit approach to working with youth, which look at the young people as a problem that needs to be fixed and remedied by focusing on youth potential strength and potential contribution. Malaysia National Youth Development Framework is not conducive to the monopolization of power. All parties have their own roles to play, be they youth or adult, private or public, rural or urban. On the part of University Putra Malaysia, the cooperation between IPSAS and the Ministry of Youth and Sports was first established way back in 1970s. To date, IPSAS continue to work closely with KBS, especially the Institute for Youth Research Malaysia, also known as IRIS, in conducting impact studies aimed at improving the well-being of Malaysian youth. UPM continues to support the call Al-Falah by supporting programs like this to elevate human beings to their rightful place as a caliph of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth. This driven by UPM mission statement, which is to make a meaningful contribution to the formation of prosperity and national development and well-being of human beings through the exploration and dissemination of knowledge. Ladies and gentlemen, before we proceed to the lecture, which is the highlight of today's event, it is my pleasure to share with you a brief background of His Highness. His Highness Tengku Amir Shah was born on 12 December 1990 and took the oath of office as Raja Muda of Selangor on the 8th October 2016 at Balairung Sri Istana Alam Shah. His Highness received his primary and secondary education at Ellie Smith School, Kuala Lumpur. He then attended Wellington's College, United Kingdom, from 2004 until his A level in 2009. In 2014, Tengku Amir graduated from the University of Leeds with a Bachelor of Science degree in Ecology and Environmental Biology. From the 23rd of September to the 5th of December 2014, Tengku Amir Shah underwent a rigorous military preparation course at the Army Academic Port Dickson Negeri Sembilan. He then enrolled in the Military Academy Sandhurst Camberley, Surrey on the 3rd of May 2015. He attended the Commission Course Intake 152 and graduated on 15 April 2016. Following this success, he was commissioned as an Army officer with the rank of Junior Lieutenant in the 17th Battalion of the Royal Malay Regiment on the 19th July 2016. Tengku Amir Shah also enjoyed various sports such as golf, football, extreme sports such as rafting, riding various terrain vehicles, cycling and paintball. As a prince of people's spirit, Tengku Amir does not forget his duty to serve the community. He is a royal patron of several non-governmental organizations which have the objective of helping the people improve their living standard. Among the NGOs under the Raja Muda Selangor, his auspices are the Raja Muda Selangor Foundation, Selangor Cheshire Home Welfare Organisation, Make-A-Wish Malaysia and Selangor Youth Community. Tengku Amir enjoys spending time with people, especially young people, to extend aid and participate in health awareness programs such as the danger of drug abuse and disease outbreak. His Highness Tengku Amir Shah personal interest is to deliver the first in this series of lecture is very much in line with his concern for the well-being of young people. In particular, he has contributed his thought and ideas in the formation of Selangor Youth Policy 2020, especially on the issues of national and state youth development. Ladies and gentlemen, before concluding, I would like to humbly thank everyone who directly or indirectly involved in bringing this event. Congratulations, especially to the organizing committee for a job well done. Your Highness, on behalf of UPM community, allow me again to express our gratitude to you for being with us today to deliver the inaugural lecture of the Distinguished Lecture Series on the Youth Wellbeing. This is not the end, it's not even the beginning of the end, but it's perhaps the end of the beginning. With that, thank you very much. Wabillahi taufiq wal hidayah. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you.
Thank you very much for sharing with us the insightful address, Yang Hormat Datuk Roslan, VC of UPM. A video presentation from IPSAS.
Ini merupakan program yang julung-julung kalinya diadakan di UPM dan dianjurkan oleh pihak IPSAS dengan kerjasama ISTEC and SE. Kami di IPSAS mengalu-alukan kedatangan semua hadirin di luar sana untuk mengikuti syarahan kehormat berkaitan kesejahteraan belia yang juga satu topik yang sangat signifikan pada ketika ini. Dan syarahan ini akan dimulakan oleh duli yang teramat mulia Raja Muda Selangor, Tengku Amir Shah. Selamat mendengar dan moga memberi manfaat kepada semua.
The times we're living in are unprecedented for young people, given the enormous challenges they face. The Distinguished Lecture Series on Youth Wellbeing is a new initiative to bring serious, scholarly attention to the critical issue of youth wellbeing in Malaysia and globally. IPSAS is very excited to have His Royal Highness Tengku Amir Shah, the Pro-Chancellor of UPM, a officiating the launching of this event. His ongoing commitment to youth well-being will bring needed attention to this issue. Thank you for your support, and we look forward to seeing you at future lectures.
Semoga siri syarahan yang diajukan ini berupaya menjadi pembuka minda dan menyumbang ke arah kesejahteraan belia seluruhnya sesuai dengan tema sambutan Hari Belia Kebangsaan pada tahun ini, iaitu dekad ini, dekad anda.
And we are so delighted to have Duli Yang Teramat Mulia Tengku Amir Shah to give a speech in this talk. And then of course, we want Tengku to get close to the youth and especially students. And hopefully you guys will enjoy this program and throughout all the lecture series that we're going to organize soon. Bye!
Ladies and gentlemen, before we proceed with the highlight of the events, let's welcome our musical performance this morning. The musical performance this morning is from the Music Department, Faculty of Human Ecology, University Putra Malaysia. For your information, the members of the group are students and alumni of UPM. Join me to welcome them with their easy listening rendition. Thank you very much. Thank you for the music from the Music Department Faculty of Human Ecology, University Putra Malaysia. Ladies and gentlemen, the much awaited and surely the significant event, the lecture series, the distinguished lecture series on youth well-being. His Highness Tengku Amir Shah, Ibni Sultan Sharafuddin Idris Shah Alhaj will now deliver his speech.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And a good morning to everyone. First and foremost, I would like to give another round of applause to the band. It was a wonderful start and have such a beautiful message to this morning. So thank you very much. And I would like to also give thanks to University Putra Malaysia in collaboration with International Institute of Islamic Thoughts and Civilization and Selangor Youth Community for organizing this inaugural lecture series. It is an honor to be able to share my story and aspirations in the hope that they can contribute to the well-being of the young people today. We are gathered here today around the topic of youth well-being. It is important to understand how the healthy well-being of community, a state, and nation can affect everyone here today. Youth today face more difficult and unique challenges than ever experienced by adults and leaders today. So it is important we address this matter with urgency, as if left will fester like a bad wound, creating more harm for ourselves and allowing our homes to fall apart. This all sounds terrible and dramatic, but I'm strongly optimistic and believe we can be better for ourselves and to each other. Growth doesn't stop once you graduate from university. Learning is an ongoing process throughout life. Through my experience, I have seen our well-being attacked and degraded. Some of us must admit now that it is our fault. Moments we have lied, slacked off, and not owning up to our own mistakes. Many, and even myself, have faced this. We will have a choice, and it's very simple: to be better next time or to face our consequences. And there are two also external forces that have attacked our well-being, and to name some are terrible policies and outdated constructs. Well, this is where we must work together to find a sustainable and healthier solution for us all. And like from before, it begins with admission to oneself. One area I see that too often we Malaysians try to avoid taking fault. This value is toxic and won't serve you or your community. It's hard to admit mistakes, but for me, the truth is more important. Being true to myself opens my well-being to greater heights. So now know the ways of our well-being is affecting our lives. Let's explore at what well-being really is, and I'll share what I think and I feel we can change together. Well-being has many layers, and I won't claim to know them all. But first, we must decide what well-being looks like and how we can create smart goals and targets like all parts in our life. Well-being must come from an area of self-discipline. One must admit, I find this difficult to hold. But from my experience, I seek well-being by asking some questions to myself. First of which, what higher purpose do I want to hold? What I mean by higher purpose is by grounding this with an action of selfless goals. For example, from what I have learned through military leadership and training, that leaders must serve. It is in our motto in a way. And here, now, today, I find purpose and meaning to inspire, to encourage, and raise awareness with people I care the most. Even successful organizations look at their purpose to give guidance and how they innovate and adapt. And don't be afraid to have this purpose change. We can't find this instantly. And the beauty of youth is that we may try, we can fail, and we'll try again. Another question I ask myself is, what would I like to achieve? This question is I visit regularly, almost all the time. It helps me put into perspective if the actions I'm taking truly serve my well-being by having clear targets that I would like to achieve. Another area of well-being we must test and learn is to be clear of our values and morals. We are taught this through our community, through our elders and parents. But with new technologies evolving faster than we can truly understand its ramifications, social media, for example, has presented its dark truth of how it's unraveling the real-life social structure. Therefore, we must too reevaluate our morals and social contract we have to one another. I don't have a clear understanding of well-being, but we must start to try and explore. To begin, we can say that health, relationships, career, service, and community contributions are all the basis of developing and achieving a state of being well. If we ever hope to see our beloved nation prosper to greater heights and a better future, we must prioritize well-being as our people in our nation is our most prized asset. This is where new beginnings and partnerships are forged to help our youth. This is why I'm pleased to be supporting this new distinguished lecture series on youth well-being. As another of these acts of positive change, I believe that this new initiative will provide an important forum for intellectual and scholarly discourse on the well-being of our youth and people today. The problems and challenges facing young people require input from all sectors of society, as no one is above the responsibility to our nation's youth. I am therefore proud to stand with UPM and its partners in supporting this noble initiative. I hope you will join me in supporting this effort, and thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Menjunjung kasih tuanku. Ladies and gentlemen, on stage, please welcome Yang Berbahagia Professor Dr. Abdul Latif Kraus Abdullah, Deputy Director, Institute for Social Science Studies, IPSAS, University Putra Malaysia. With honour, I call upon Prof. Dr. Latif to lead the question and answer session. Prof. Latif, the stage is all yours.
Testing. Is this working? Can you hear me? Okay. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And a very good morning to Your Highness and all of our distinguished guests here today. first start by thanking His Highness for a, I think, a very poignant and a very introspective opening lecture. And I think with that opening lecture that you just gave, Your Highness, I think you touched on a lot of the very critical issues that this distinguished lecture series hopes to address in the future. And I really love the fact that you touched on the importance of introspection, self-discipline. And these are the things that we don't hear too often when we talk about well-being anymore. And so this is, I think, a great great start to this program. So I'm going to be leading the question and answer session, the interactive session for today's program. And the session will be of two parts. So I will start by posing questions to His Highness. And following my session with His Highness, I will then open the floor to questions from the audience. And I know we have a lot of young people here today, so I would encourage the young people in the audience to step up to the microphones in the rows there and pose your questions to His Highness. And I know that he likes to interact with the young people, so we welcome your questions. Okay, so Your Highness, let me start by you touched on a lot of personal issues in your lecture just now. Can I just ask, how did you get started? How did you originally find an interest in this issue of youth development?
Thank you. Good morning. Well, I must admit, you know, coming into youth development was more of a stumble to me. But it's always in a way, it leads back to more of a sense of duty and higher purpose is what I was trying to lead on. And for me, what I was looking at was, how best can I serve as Raja Muda? What is in my position that I can do that can give back to the community as best possible, in a most effective way? And so going into youth development, so yes, it was a stumble in the sense, you know, I come back to Malaysia, I was studying abroad for almost 10 years, and I wanted to know and understand first, who is my community? Who is the youth, and who is the people of Selangor? And that's sort of what led me into starting Selangor Youth Community, because I first discovered that my home city, Shah Alam, is 70% under 35. So we are a very young city, and a lot of it is to do with, you know, various education institutions, colleges, and whatnot. So, but that still, you know, opened up the question on what can I do for them? And that sort of led me to discover the four pillars of SAY, you know, looking at entrepreneurship, looking at well-being and health, looking at sports, culture, and community service. So with that, you know, I always find it easier for me to have these open discussions because, like you said at the beginning, I prefer to engage and to interact. You know, so please forgive me that my lecture was short, but I find that it'd be short and sweet will keep most of your attention because I used to be a student too. So yeah, that's, you know, in a way that's what led me into youth well-being. And also I took inspiration from my father, Tengku Sultan. You know, when I was a young age, he started Yayasan Raja Muda. And the foundation, the Yayasan, is to look at how underprivileged and students that are left behind. Because we all know that not all systems are perfect. And the education system is not perfect either. And there are times where we will find students that don't quite follow the category or follow the system in line that has been put in place. And but does that mean that they are useless? Does that mean that they are not part of our community too? Because they too have, you know, capabilities and strengths and, you know, abundance that they can share with the community, but just maybe not in the form that we have constructed in our society. So Yayasan Raja Muda tries to give and empower young people to look at other skills than the normal of education, looking at vocational skills, looking at technical training, and nowadays with the changing climate, you know, we're looking at computer literacy, electrical engineering, automobile are some of the various courses that we provide scholarship for.
Great, thank you. So in relation to that, I know you did mention also in your lecture about this desire to really help underprivileged young people as well. What do you see as some of the challenges or some of the biggest challenges in addressing the needs of underprivileged youth nowadays?
Well, the biggest difficulty I see addressing underprivileged youth is that we are constantly telling that they are underprivileged, you know? If you are being told you're underprivileged and you're being told that you're not in the right place, you're not fitting in the right community, it takes a toll on one's person's self. And I feel that we need to first start this, changing this conversation, changing the way we look at people. And it's more that what we're trying to do is bring their best potential out, is what I'm trying to achieve. So, yes, you know, the biggest challenge is one is the way that they are looked at and the way that we can give their confidence or taking away confidence from them. So with my experience and through my work, we are looking at more on the foundations on building and creating young, dependable young people. And, you know, some of these foundations we look at is looking at, you know, intrapersonal skills, communication skills, leadership skills. These are all things, you know, that need to be taught. It doesn't just come naturally. Even for myself, you know, I was gone through all these different courses to learn and to understand how to be a leader. You know, it doesn't just come naturally overnight. Yeah. So what else I also see with the challenges of youth today is that there's an immense amount of distraction all around us. You know, it's hard to see because I have friends now that are becoming parents, and the technology that is there available, you know, distracting our youth today. And it's so easy as well for as parents and families to just cave into those things.
Yes, that is a very big issue, I think, for all of us as parents. We can see every day how distracted we all are, actually. In terms of looking at young people as looking at their strengths, building on their strengths, as you mentioned, how can we help young people become catalysts for change? And I know that's a lot about what SAY is all about, and the work that SAY does. So how do you see that?
Youth have a big part in play in our community. And I think that is something that's quite hard for a lot of people to grasp. I mean, they understand that, but to truly, even the adults, you could say, the leaders today, it is difficult for everyone to accept that the youth need to be part of our community, need to have a bigger say and contribution to our community. I think the main thing, of course, that I would tell to other young people, the most important thing is to be kind, to show kindness to each other. Because it's too easy for us, especially in this world, again, with technologies and distractions, that we are constantly, what's the word, you know, we're always shooting down each other. We're always, you know, pointing fingers and not realizing the blame we're actually wanting to put is in ourselves, you know? So youth today, you know, be strong, be bold, but you also must be to listen and to be kind. Because there's no point in having all these great ideas and all this sort of energy, but you're bulldozing every relationship behind you. That is not what life is about. You know, life, more importantly, is the relationships that we hold with each other, you know, from students and teachers, amongst colleagues, amongst friends. if we start burning relationships, burning that trust, that social contract we have each other, then it's that well-being of that nation is going to quickly deteriorate and harder to recover from. So, yes, so catalysts for the youth, you know, they absolutely can, because the energy that they have, the passion, I've seen so much passion and so much joy in the last 5 years working with youths, and it's really, it fuels me. It fuels me when I see that, and it makes me wanting to also spread their story across.
Yes, I agree with you. It is very inspiring, especially being involved in the field of youth development since the early 90s. So, bringing people together of different generations, different backgrounds, bringing adults and youth together. If you were to advise us adults, you know, maybe some of us adults we're not that familiar with how to work with youth, how to bring up their strengths. Well, how would you advise us adults when it comes to helping young people find their way and about in terms of all these things you just mentioned? What would you advise us?
I think what we would like to see, what the youth would like to see more of, is quite basically, is more honesty and more show of integrity. You know, youth, especially Malaysia, people in Malaysia, we are led by examples. We are led by leaders and people around us that we look up to, that share our values, share our morals, and by adults showing more honesty will allow more youth to follow. More youth will then believe and pull the line in a way. You know, especially amongst our community elders, you know, personalities of influence. It is hard to see now, you know, like I said, the distractions, our media is always trying to point out the lies, the deceit, and the spin on the relationships that is probably not even really there. So it's easy for us to be fooled on what's going on. So I think, you know, the adults today, the simplest way is to show and to lead by example of what values and what goals that we want to achieve together.
Okay, thank you. In relation to your comment about the distractions that young people are constantly facing every day, I think it's also true that a lot of young people are very disillusioned by the fact that there's so much negativity around them, especially on social media. They see so much negativity. They see so much, especially negativity about leaders, about adults, whether they're political leaders or whatnot. So if I were to ask you, Your Highness, advice to young people now, how would you advise young people to sort of rise above that negativity so that they can find themselves and find their place in society?
Yeah, I mean, this is something that even, you know, my friends, people I know, other young people have all struggled with, this sort of negativity, these distractions that is bombarding us constantly and relentlessly. You know, you can scroll till you die. It's just endless scroll. You know, you can be stuck in this loop. So my advice today for all the youth here is to be present, to look and to realize where you are here and today, and look at the relationships of the people that you're sitting next to. You know, put all those external gadgets down for once. You know, have a moment for yourself to say, no, I don't need my phone. You know, you think about it, 30 years ago, before I was born, they didn't have phones. So what is not, the problem is not the human being, it's what these external factors are trying to put us down. I won't say I have much advice on how to eliminate this. There are many books out there, and I'm sure your professors can lead you into that direction. But let me take an example that I do for myself and what I've learned and I share with others. You know, one of the first teachings that Allah has given us is learning about our intentions, learning about niyat. Because whatever we do, the beginning of each prayer, the beginning of whatever action you must take, by having a niyat, by having intention, makes you more focused, makes you more present on what you are doing and where you are. So I repeat this a lot, especially to athletes. You know, I'm in charge of the Selangor football club. I'm also a patron of the Malaysian sailing team. So I always tell athletes, when you come to training, it's not just your job. Yes, you're a professional athlete, but if you come here with more intention, with more reason for your training will be more successful. So again, how do we get away from this delusion? How do we make ourselves take away this negativity? Is to be more present, to realize, to look after our friendships, our families, and to have that intent.
Great, thank you. Once again, I think introspection is a very big theme there that you hit on, which is very important. And it is very hard to be introspective when we're constantly distracted by all the external things going on around us. So the last question I have for His Highness relates to your work with SEI, okay, and the Yayasan Selangor. And this in university, we're always being reminded to make sure that our students are future ready. You hear this all the time. Our students have to be future ready, future ready. And what's ironic is that we don't know what the future holds. So how do you prepare someone for the unknown, so to speak? How do you think SEI and the work that you've done with the Yayasan Selangor has helped young people to be future ready?
Yeah, that's a wonderful question. And you hit that right. You know, what is the future? You know, can we imagine, you know, not even 3 years ago that we'd be going through the most horrific pandemic that we have known in modern day? I have never thought in a million years I would have betted on that. And yes, so let me explain a little bit what SEI, Selangor Youth Community, and the Yayasan do. We basically host many different variety of programs. The Yayasan in specific is looking at education, and Selangor Youth Community is building relationships amongst other NGOs, other charities, to help and catalyze their ideas in a better way for the community as well. So for example, what we have in Selangor Youth Community, we have a global partnership with Princess Trust International in the UK. And we have a very unique program called Teams. It's a 9-week program, again, looking at future ready for students and for young people, youth at risk specifically. And what does that mean by future ready? So it's looking at leadership skills, communication skills, presentation skills. Many of these sort of soft skills, I could say, is very much underlooked in the education system. The education system in many countries, not fault to Malaysia alone, is very much focused on passing grades, giving as many A stars, A plus as possible into that one cohort. So teachers are now not as much focused in developing students and their classes, but more on trying to make sure that their class is the best in the examinations. So it's very difficult, you know, for them, because they also are driven and want to succeed. So KPIs are set in that way. So again, back to Yayasan and Selangor Youth Community, I'm hoping to be able to fill those gaps that we are missing and hopefully inspire other groups, other NGOs, because this sort of lessons and work is not just something you can learn overnight. It's something that you need to practice. It's something that you need to harness as well. On the other side as well with Selangor Youth Community, again, what I mentioned earlier is that we have 4 pillars. So we look at these pillars and see where we can contribute back to the community. You know, for example, we are doing entrepreneurship programs, and I believe Selangor, we need to be competitive
outside of Malaysia, you know, as an economy. It's not Selangor versus Pahang. You know, I know that's exciting. You know, that's a game tomorrow night. Or it's not something that we should be competing with ourselves as Malaysians, but we should be looking at how to develop and export as much as we can. You know, I have some friends in the food technology, and he was sharing with me, he's making food packages and subscription in the UK, and he was specifically for young kids. And I saw that he was giving dry fruits, and I look at the packaging, made in Thailand. I was like, oh, we have all these fruits here in Malaysia. You know, why are we not doing the same thing and developing and marketing? So the program has helped to build these young companies, these SMEs, into outward looking. So we help by connecting them with government and take them around to meetings and pitching their ideas to other distributors that would want to take up their product. So these are just some of the few examples that we do. And so yeah, future ready. It's a difficult one. It's always changing. It's always evolving. But I find most rewarding, and what I think quite unique to Malaysia, is that the service that we give to others. You know, I see a lot of volunteers. I see a lot of mentors giving their time to helping and nurturing the youth, to making sure that they are getting the best out of themselves, you know, reaching their full potential. So I find, you know, those areas are good guidance on how to maintain the right direction in developing our youth to be better.
Great, thank you very much. I think you hit on some really important points there as well, especially with Future Ready. It's a very difficult challenge for all of us. And I don't think anybody was ready for what happened in these past 3 years, but we had to work through it. Okay, so I don't have any more questions for Your Highness. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
For your engaging answers. But now I would, yes, thank you. But now I would like to open up to the floor for questions from the audience for His Highness. So if you have a question, you are welcome to just step up to the microphone. And if you could just state your name and maybe where you're from, and then go ahead and pose your question. So the young man on the right.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Assalamualaikum. Allow me to unmask myself. His Highness, good morning to everyone and distinguished guests. My name is Helmi Halley. Currently, I'm pursuing my studies and PhD, Leadership in Youth, under the Institute for Social Sciences Studies, aka IPSAS. Okay, His Highness, I would like to highlight a certain situation in Malaysia currently. I think for you to know that there are many young people nowadays, they are looking for jobs under the gig economy rather than working with the companies. Even though the salaries and the pay is almost the same. So would you like to share? My question is, if you were faced with these options, what would you choose? To work with the gig economy or to start with the companies? And you might share with us also why. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Helmi, for that question. Now it's a very interesting question, because our youth today is also changing in what they need and what they want in their life. They are no longer driven to be part of institutions, to be part of a bigger corporation. They want to be their own leaders, their own leaders of their own destiny, you could say. So, I mean, it's hard for me to answer that because I've chosen the more institutional route already. You know, for me, I was about 15 years old. I went to Tengku, Ayanda, and I asked him, I want to join the army. And he was like, are you sure? Are you really sure you want to join the army? But I was so drawn to that idea because in a way it was like living in boarding school for the rest of my life, you know? I enjoyed being together as a community of brothers, of working hard for each other, of suffering together. You know, it's a really interesting and a strange way of life that's really hard to describe. And so I've chosen that way. So if I had to choose it again, I'll still go that way again. But you're right, you know, it is difficult because with the gig economy, there's no insurances for yourself and for your future. So that is something that if you wish to go down that route, you need to prepare your own future and you need to prepare your own insurances for yourself because the state is not going to cover it and there is no corporation covering it. So it is a lot more responsibility, and I think that's what's being misunderstood in the youth today, that going into the gig economy has other responsibilities that you need to look out for. So instead of trying to put gig versus corporate as the question, maybe we should instead, how do we make sure the gig economy is safer for our community and for the youth? So thank you for that interesting question.
Thank you, Your Highness. Thank you, Hilmi, for the question. I think that's another area where us youth researchers have to really go into, because there's so much we don't know really about, especially how young people are making these decisions and why they're making these decisions and all the things you just spoke of as well. Thank you, Hilmi, for that question. Is there another questioner out there? Maybe we start on this side. Yes, please, sir. Yes. Go ahead.
Bismillah. Okay, Assalamualaikum, Your Highness. My name is Sharafuddin, and I came from University of Malaya in bachelor degree creative arts. My question is, do you, as a Raja Muda Selangor, do you have an initiative about the mental health among the youth? We know that every single day, many of the youth get the mental illness, especially depressions and so many. Do you have an initiative? Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning. That was a really, really good question because I'm really glad you brought up about mental health because youth well-being, you know, I had a quick, went into a YouTube university for a few hours before I came, and the first thing you see on youth well-being is mental health because it is, you know, I had actually a little bit of a longer speech, but it was a bit too sad because I was pointing out how badly it's been going. And I didn't want to, you know, I think we all know that especially the pandemic has caused and exasperated the issues of mental health for our youth today. You know, so many young people were living alone. So many young people were living without knowing what the future was really holding, because there was expectations from years and decades already been played. You know, we've had the playbook. You go to school, you go to university, you get a job, and you know, you're enjoying your life. But then suddenly this pandemic has put like, okay, education must stop. We can't see each other and we must go online. You know, that too was very confusing and difficult because, you know, I had a few programs that had to go online and it was not, you know, as effective as I wanted it to be. So, but we had to adapt, and that's the thing. So there is no specific program that I host that is related to or specifically to mental health well-being, but there are a lot of programs that I'm doing that is trying to promote it and trying to raise awareness around it. So I've always lent my name and my support to anything that's to do with mental health, especially now because, like I said, the well-being of our youth is being degraded, and mental health is one of the key areas because the anxiety, the stress, you know, how do we fix this? You know, this is something that we need to discuss, and I hopefully in this lecture series is something that you guys can open up to and figure out how we can be stronger and more resilient. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much for the question and for the response, Your Highness. Okay. Yes, I think one of the silver linings in the pandemic was that it brought to light the need for a stronger safety net when it comes to mental health for young people. So I think we've learned from that, if nothing else. Yes. So inshallah, things will improve in the future. Okay. We have met several questioners. Okay, so I think there's a young woman waiting on this side. Yes?
Okay.
Okay, we'll alternate, yeah? Right, left. Okay. Go ahead, please. Go ahead.
Thank you, His Highness, for such a valuable lecture. My name is Mariette Cabrera. I'm a master's student at ISTAC. My question is, previously in the past, most businesses' management theories focus on productivity and efficiency. Nowadays, business management theories are taking into consideration such things as employee satisfaction and psychological well-being. Do you think this difference in thinking indicates a shift towards a more value-based thinking rather than the previous quantitative thinking? Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning. Yes, Mariam, I think there's definitely a shift that is happening and a shift that is definitely needed. You know, you look at corporations that want to be successful and want to have a longer lasting in this world, they need to shift and adapt to the times of our people. You know, corporations cannot run on their own without us. You know, I think we get to forget that corporations become very big and very powerful, but actually they are only as strong as the people that they hold within. So if corporations want to add more value, they need to retain their workforce that are willing and like I said, job satisfaction. You know, these are areas of well-being that we are all starting to look at. So it's good that, you know, these corporations are being challenged, because it makes us to see that, you know, if it makes us, you know, wanting to grow and adapt and be better. So thank you.
Great. Thank you very much for the question. Thank you, Your Highness. Okay, so let's go back to the left side here. Would you like to ask your question? Go ahead.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh, Your Highness. My name is Muhammad Idham from Faculty of Forestry and Environment. Environmental sustainability has always been an issue, not only globally, but also in Malaysia. So in your opinion and your advice, how can our youth, not only in Selangor, but also in Malaysia, can contribute meaningfully to its environmental sustainability in achieving our sustainable development goals? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for that wonderful question as well, because I'm also very glad you brought up about nature, or in this case, you know, environmental sustainability. Because if we can look back in terms of well-being, do you guys not find it more enjoyable and feel better about yourself when you go out into nature? When you walk in a park, when you walk through the jungle or by the river or by the ocean, you immediately have that sense of well-being brought to you. You feel that joy, that calmness, that energy, you know, in the right place. So with that in mind, therefore, shouldn't be our environment be one of our highest priorities to sustain and make sure our well-being is protected? And I agree with that. I totally agree that we need to have a much better policies in looking after our nature, in looking after our wildlife, because if we forget about them, if we don't look after them, then we will quickly destroy it all. And that opportunity to have that sort of nature well-being will be eroded and we'll never find it again. So yes, I think there needs to be more work done. I don't have a solution on the exact what it will look like, but it needs to be a balance for sure, that government and institutions that are protecting the environment must have a clear understanding on their goals. So understanding where the city needs to be, you know, do we need to keep expanding and having our city so big that we all need to drive cars and everything, all the trees are torn down? Or can we look at building smarter cities, working with architects, working with engineers, to building cities that are a bit more closer to each other and protecting the surrounding environment and creating an ecosystem of environmental services, you know, rangers, education, you know, trekking through the jungle is, you know, there are ways that we can build services around this. So yeah, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Idham, for your question. Now back to the other side. There's a young woman there.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Thank you, Your Majesty, for this opportunity. Actually, I want to ask you, as Your Highness mentioned that you're working for youth well-being is your priority to work on and one of your priority goals. As we all know, there are a lot of refugee youth in Malaysia who their life has been destroyed and they have no hope to hold on to life anymore. So I would like to ask you, is working for those refugee young people has been any part of your work or your priority to at least giving them hope to hold on to get back to the community, to like to make sure that they are also healthy youth and they are also part of the community. Thank you so much.
Walaikum salam. And yes, thank you for bringing up on this issue about refugees. You know, I like to say that, you know, we do a little bit of work with refugees. I had a few community programs in looking at, there were basically young students and they were living in a sort of shop house. So we sort of rebuilt their living area and their communal areas. So to make them have a much, you know, it was just an empty four-wall room at the beginning. So we gave them furniture, books, and stuff that they can, you know, occupy their time. You know, I'm appalled. I'm appalled to say that our government does not support refugees. You know, it is something so sad that we talk about as Malays to be hospitable. We talk about being Malay and Malaysian to be open-armed and multicultural. But we can't even say, we can't even extend our hands to a refugee because they are being oppressed by another nation. And we can't recognize that. That really is sad to me that our government is not able to do that. And I think that if we did, if we one day open our arms to refugees, we will have so much, we will have even more colorful things to say and share in Malaysia. You know, there are so many people here, so many refugees here in Malaysia that, you know, if we, you know, we talk about issues about the, you know, lack of jobs or lack of people in the working community. You know, if we allow them to work, if we can just recognize refugees as human beings that should be able to work, have an education, have a health plan, you know, we will be a much better off Malaysia, I think. And yeah, so it's really sad that for us right now in the NGO world, in the charity world, we can only support them sort of unofficially. And yeah, so we do try, and I do, you know, when I do have a case that we are to do work with refugees, we will do it. So thank you for raising that up.
Yes, thank you for the question, Sister. Okay, so do you have time for a few?
Yeah, keep talking. Thank you. I find this much easier and much open to share like this than me just speaking on a text.
Okay, great. Okay, yes, young man.
Assalamu alaikum and a very good morning to Your Highness. So I have a younger brother who was an SPM student in 2021. So I have a question for you on what is your opinion on 72% of the SPM 2021 student who doesn't want to pursue their studies. So which means after the SPM, maybe they just want to continue their living in their home with their parents or just want to collect money to earn for living. So what is your opinion on that? Is it something good for our young youth, or is it something bad or something else? So thank you.
Thank you. Whether it's good or bad, we must first investigate what is their intention, again, what is their purpose, and why are they choosing this direction in life. And I think, again, the pandemic has shown that going into education, you might not have the best time. You might not be receiving the best form because you're always online, you're not having that face-to-face interaction. So people maybe are saying, maybe, you know, the 72% maybe don't want to go to further education today, but it doesn't mean that they don't want to learn, I think. So we have to be very careful about the statistics as well and what we analyze. So it's not that I don't think that it's not that they are not opening to be learning and opening to further educate their minds. It's just they don't feel that the current situation is worth their money, worth their time. So that's what I think is happening, in my opinion. But again, like I said, you know, through my yayasan, we have other programs that we look at vocational skills especially, because there are many ways that you can find satisfaction and well-being in life, and it's not necessarily always the normal, predictable way. So we have to be, I think we have to be cautious on that, on what's going on, but also be mindful that, you know, I think our parents and mentors need to play a big role to make sure to ask these questions, you know, because we can't allow our youth to just go blindly into whatever direction. Thank you.
Thank you for the question. Yeah, I think we really have to understand, we can't take those statistics on face value. You said, we have to really understand what's behind them. That's the most important thing. Yeah, great question. Okay, can we go back to the right side now, young lady?
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Nadia from School of Business and Economic. I'm from Indonesia. Your Highness, you create the best community in your country. But how with the young generation that they didn't enjoy or they just love about the hedonism, how to create the social awareness to them if they didn't join any kind of youth community? So how to solve this kind of problem? Because sometimes in my country, the young generation, they love from the social media. Oh, it's easy to being rich, being successful. They didn't see about how hard our life to achieve something. So how to make them realize we need to study hard, we need to create the better future. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Yes, you know, our youth, they're easily distracted. We're easily distracted. You know, the world is making it harder and harder for us, for sure. It's, you know, I don't know, because what I've experienced is that a lot of youth are participating. They are willing to participate. They're willing to join into programs. They're not so much shying away from it, but they're maybe sometimes not aware of it as well. So, I don't know, my advice in this would be to make sure that a lot of institutions have as much programs and societies as possible, and that once you start to leave university, to maintain in a society, to maintain in a group that you spend once a month on a weekend, that are sharing a cause or sharing an idea that is not something that you have with you every day. You know, for example, like we were talking about nature, that you join a community that focuses on nature, and you will start to gain relationships with people that have that similar mindset, and then you open up your ideas. So I think the strength here is trying to build, right, a stronger community, to be more together and to share that to share our values. Yeah, so I don't really have an answer on what's the solution here, but nobody does at the moment. But as long as we keep encouraging, I think you got to keep encouraging, you know. Mm-hmm. I think maybe the next step, you know, after this is to look at parenting skills. Mm-hmm. There is no school on how to be a parent, right? And we only learn from our own parents. But what if we don't have a good relationship with our parent? Where are you going to learn from? Yep. You know? And there are many people like that, that don't have that guidance that they can look up to. So maybe we need to be for each other, you know, our own peers. We need to look after our brothers and sisters as well. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for the question. Thank you, Your Highness, for the answer. It is a difficult, very difficult question to answer.
Thank you. So
unfortunately, we only have about 5 more minutes according to our schedule. So we will try to finish up the questions quickly. Okay, so yes, next, on the left side.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. To His Highness and members of the floors, my name is Bella Rusty, and currently I'm doing my PhD in leadership. So basically, I totally agree with you, Highness. You're talking about the leadership, communication skills, the personality that the youth nowadays should have in their development. So we are currently facing an issue in which imposter syndrome. So imposter syndrome is about the lack of confidence, where they are trying very hard to prove that they are good, they are have confidence. So it's such an honor if you can share your point of view about how or what is the smartest way for us to struggle this so that we can appear better, we can be perform better in public. That's all from me. Thank you.
That's a very interesting question. Thank you. So you're asking how you think we can be more confident, is it? How we can be better leaderships in a way?
Smartest way.
A smarter leadership. Well, I don't know. I think in school for me, it starts from school, you know, that confident building, that schools need to be able to allow students to make and grow and make mistakes, you know, especially as well, even into university. You need to be able to see the army. So what's really interesting is the army, especially in officership schools, we start off with leadership and then we train you to become a soldier. We train you the skills of warfare. But in the corporate world, you learn the skills and tools of a corporate trade, right? Whether it's marketing, accounting, and then later on, they teach you about leadership and management. So I think there's something to be learned here from both sides of the world, from the military and civilian world, that how it's been taught. So that's why you see a lot of like talks around the world. They always bring an ex-officer, an ex-soldier to talk about leadership. It's because for us in the military, leadership starts right from the beginning. And if I had to break it down, what really leadership is, it's about having good relationships. It's about understanding, for me, understanding my soldiers. What are their needs? What are their problems? Because everyone has other problems that, you know, your life is not just about work or about the school. You have other things. You have more than that. So as a leader, you need to understand, you know, if you're a manager, in a corporation or a director, you need to understand the people around you have also other lives. You know, you can't make them you the center of their life. And creating good leadership and smart leadership, again, it's first to understand your values. So, you know, I like to refer a lot back to my military because it makes sense to me, because the first thing we'd learn in the first 5 weeks is values. I remember to this day, and we named it as an acronym as C-drills: courage, discipline, respect for others, integrity, and loyalty. This is the basic building blocks of building a soldier and an officer. If we break any of those values, we are losing trust amongst each other. And in a battlefield, if you lose trust, that's it. That could be a meaning of end of your life. So So values was always been drilled to be the core of what we need to be. So maybe creating a good leadership, a smart leader, is that a leader needs to understand what values he is trying to instill in the organization and management skills that he wants to apply. Thank you.
Great, thank you very much. It's a very interesting, this focusing on values, a very interesting way of framing that issue of leadership. Mm. Thank you. Okay, yes, on the right side, we have our young man in the green shirt. Yeah.
Assalamualaikum and good morning, Your Highness and everyone. My name is Muhammad Afiq bin Abdul Razak. I'm master student, University Putra Malaysia. And my question is, as a youth, what we can do or what we can contribute to the to empower our community? Thank you.
Thank you. I think what the youth can do to empower the community is, like I said, showing kindness to each other, being present, being, you know, participating, you know. I want to see Malaysians to be more vocal as well, to share, you know. Yes, be respectful, of course. That is our true value of being in Malaysia and being Asian, that we have respect to our elders. But it doesn't mean that, you know, bringing your ideas or raising your you know, fears is something to be afraid of. So find ways to speak up and find ways to engage and to be part of the community and to help each other with sincerity. Thank you.
Great, thank you very much. Okay, guys, I think we only have time for two more questions. I'm really sorry. Okay, I'm really sorry, but I think our schedule only permits us to have time for two more questions. So the young man on the left.
Assalamualaikum. Your Highness, allow me to introduce myself. My name is Arkan Binatara Pratama. I'm an Indonesian student from the Student Representative Council for Faculty of Food Science and Technology. Talking about well-being, in my personal opinion, we need to see that in a more holistical approach. What is your thoughts on the well-being of students, not just from the mental health point of view, but also from the aspects such as economical, access to opportunity, and personal growth?
Thank you. Yes, you know, like I said, I think well-being is being attacked at the moment, especially youth well-being. And, you know, the pandemic has made it worse for us and has made it very uncertain what sort of jobs we are trying to get, what skills we need. So what I think, again, it's a very difficult question for me to answer on exactly how we're going to improve our well-being, but it's important to start first to have awareness on where well-being is and how we prioritize that well-being. You know, for some people, it's always different for every person, you know? So, you know, like I think from the previous question, we need to raise our voice to our adults, to our leaders, like, hey, you know, I'm trying my hardest here, I'm working, I'm studying, but I'm not getting what I need. So I think it's very important that the youth need to be able to stand up and raise their voice appropriately and effectively, you know? Thank you.
Thank you, Ryan.
Okay, thank you. Okay, our last question. I'm really sorry again, but our last question on the right, young woman on the right.
All right, thank you. Assalamualaikum and a very good morning to Your Highness and the audiences today. So my question is similar with the recent question from the young man, which is regarding the further study or not. So, but my question, I will be narrowing down to the factors that currently being talked now. So when we talk about your well-being, we are focusing on the future generation. So if we scroll down social media, the current issue highly discussed regarding further study or straight to working field. So some of them mentioning that to further study now, having them to get a loan or a financial aid for their tuition fee. And compared to working and earning money due to the current economic situations. So there is a group of people that preaching these youngsters that it's fine to not further study and just go to work or just build your business and be a billionaire. That's the facts that we're having now on social media. So, we have been told for decades that access to education is the number one key to success in life. So, in your personal opinion, is it still relevant or there is a revolution in this matter in our youth and future generation? And do you agree regarding the economic situation has been an obstacle for these youngsters to further their studies? Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
It's a very strong and powerful last question we have to end the day. And let's put it up in a few words, in a few ways to put this. Let's say, okay, so,
The grand finale.
Yeah, how do we break this down? No, I think like what I said before, and about, you know, the idea that 72% don't want to continue their education, is not so much that they do not want to be educated, it's just that they might not see the value, and they've been spun this idea that, yeah, it's too expensive now to get an education, go find this easier and shortcut way to be whatever you want to be. And it works probably less than 1% of the time. And the rest of the 99% have wasted their time, wasted probably their savings, and realized that they made a mistake. So, and that those stories are never told. You know, social media, Instagram and all that, TikTok only show the best part of things. They never show the struggles. They never show the hard work, because that's not interesting. Who's going to scroll and watch a guy do his homework, you know? So, you know, you're not seeing the hard work that's been put behind all this stuff that has been content created for you. So, I still think education has tremendous value, because you're not just learning what you get on the scroll. You know, bachelor in science, bachelor in arts, you know, PhD in social science and whatnot. You also have gathered relationships. Again, you have made friendships. You have learned valuable lessons and new things from your mentors, from your professors, that you can't get in a book, that you can't just get on Wikipedia or, you know, University of YouTube. So I still think, you know, it's important that we come back to some sort of formal education. And maybe we can also pose a question to the corporations. Maybe they should start an education program, you know? When they have new people come in, should they not have a 1 or 2 year sort of graduate program to further their skills, to further their leaderships and management skills and whatnot? So I think, yeah, so for me, I believe education must be ongoing and cannot stop. Again, I refer back to my experience of, you know, my Tengku Ayanda. My father, he always tells me, pretty much every time I see him, read. Read your history and do your homework. So reading, in a way, is learning. So, yeah, so I would tell those people, you know, those young people, you know, like I said, reevaluate what your priorities are. Maybe your priority is right now is financial. It's you need to make money because, and therefore you make some smart decisions on how you're going to do that, you know. So I don't think everyone's options should be discounted or think it's right or wrong, but we should not devalue people's choices. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for all your wonderful questions. And I think from the nature of the questions, Your Highness, you can see that this is a very difficult issue that we're getting into.
Yes.
And I really, we really appreciate you taking the time to not only give us, start us off with the opening lecture for the series, but engaging with our audience and answering very difficult questions.
Yeah.
So thank you very much.
I'd like to also take this moment again to thank the University of Putra Malaysia. I'd like to thank them for, you know, hosting this this wonderful lecture series. And again, these are very deep topics, and hopefully there will be meaningful conversations that come out of it. And hopefully we can share that with everyone, you know, beyond the university world as well, that what we find and what we discover, because I think well-being is such an important thing of what we all need to achieve as a nation. Because if we can measure, you know, there are some countries in the world that do measure well-being, you know, and I'm sure you guys are aware of that. So if we can make sure our well-being is strong, and I'm very certain that the future Malaysia will be also strong. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So now I turn it back to our MC.
Menjunjung kasih tuanku. Thank you very much, Prof. Latif, for a productive session. On behalf of our organizer, I would like to thank you for the session today. May I ask Your Highness to remain on stage for the next event? Before we move on to the next agenda, I would like to call upon Yang Hormat Datuk Profesor Dr. Muhammad Roslan Sulaiman, Vice Chancellor UPM, accompanied by Yang Berbahagia Profesor Dr. Hasida Abdullah, Yang Berbahagia Profesor Dr. Abdul Aziz, and Yang Berusaha Puan Nurul Azwa Rozi, CEO of SEI, to come on stage to present a token of appreciation to His Highness. Now, we are moving to our next agenda, the launching of Belia Juara. For your information, Belia Juara is a brainchild, of His Royal Highness, His Raja Muda Selangor, aims to develop a dynamic, vibrant and progressive youth community. Belia Juara provides grants and platform for youth individuals and organizations to create positive impacts in their local community, aligned with the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. The grant will focus on the element of youth development and volunteerism, not just in Selangor. Youth individuals and organizations from across Malaysia and ASEAN country can also apply for this grant. His Royal Highness Tengku Amir Shah, Raja Muda of Selangor, will now launch the Belia Juara program. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome on stage Mr. Muhammad Afiq Abdul Razak to receive the first Belia Juara Grant from His Highness Raja Muda Selangor. This grant will be utilized for youth development and volunteerism programs under Belia Juara. Congratulations, Afiq. Boys and girls, grab the chance. Go and check out SAY website for more information. As what said by His Highness just now, youth, be strong, be bold, be participative, be present. Ladies and gentlemen, now we arrive at our historic event, the signing of Memorandum of Understanding, MOU, between the University Putra Malaysia, UPM, and Selangor Youth Community, SAY. The signee from the University Putra Malaysia, Yang Hormat Datuk Profesor Dr. Muhammad Roslan Sulaiman, Vice Chancellor. Second, Yang Berbahagia Profesor Dr. Hasinda Abdullah, Director IPSAS UPM. The signee from Selangor Youth Community will be Ms. Nurul Azwa Rozi, Chief Executive Officer, and Mr. Zaifriz Hadziri Zairul, Chief Operation Officer. And today's celebrated event to be witnessed by His Highness Tengku Amir Shah himself, Raja Muda of Selangor, Yang Berbahagia Profesor Dr. Ismi Arif Ismail, Deputy Vice Chancellor, Academic and International UPM, and Yang Berbahagia Profesor Dr. Abdul Aziz, the Dean of ISTEC. The collaboration between UPM and SAY will create more impact, greater impact to the youth development in Selangor and in Malaysia especially. Our prayer will be with UPM and SAY. What an event without a photo to capture this remarkable moment. Congratulations UPM and congratulations SAY. And now I would like to request His Highness and the distinguished guests to return to their seats. Thank you. Before we end our event for today, let's relax a bit, unwind, and let's welcome back again our musical group. Let me allow myself to introduce the member, Haziq, the vocalist and also the guitarist, Putri, the vocalist, Andreas E, the drums, and our musical group is led by Dr. Ahmad Fauzi Musib, the violinist and also the guitarist. Join me to welcome again our band. Thank you.
enjoyed the show. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Haziq, Putri, Andreas, and Dr. Fauzi. Let's give them another round of applause. Your Highness, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of our event this morning. On behalf of the organizing committee, I extend my heartfelt gratitude to His Highness Tengku Amir Shah, Ibni Sultan Sharafuddin Idris Shah Alhaj, Raja Muda of Selangor, for gracing this event. Menjunjung kasih tuanku. To all the participants, we would like to thank you for your time and support for this event. Hope to see you again next time. Announcing the departure of His Highness Tengku Amir Shah Ibni Sultan Sharafuddin Idris Shah Alhaj, Raja Muda of Selangor.
Bila bertalu rentak di kalbu, hasrat yang tersirat semakin kuburu. Bila bergema laungan gempita, harapan bernyala, nadiku berganda.
Please proceed to the registration table for the participants to collect your packed lunch and proceed to the left side of the table, of the hall. sekian dari saya, yang terbaik daripada Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala dan yang buruk daripada kelemahan diri saya sendiri. Wabillahi taufiq wa hidayah. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh. Hope to see you guys again. Thank you.
Dari puncak ingin ke angkasa.